Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Andy Stanley Leadership Podcast, a conversation designed to help leaders go further, faster. I'm Andy. And before we jump into today's content, I wanted to talk for just a minute about a special offer from our friends at Belay. Whether you're part of a startup, a small business, or maybe a large organization, what we have in common is we all want to grow our organizations and we want to get better as leaders. But you need extra time to do what only you can do as a leader, and you don't need to be doing the things that you're probably not all that good at anyway, right? And this is where our friends at Belay can be of extraordinary help. Belay will help you free up your time and allow you to focus on the things that allow you to be most successful, the things that only you can do or that you do best, your best value adds for your organization. Because whether you need an exceptional US-based virtual assistant, an accounting professional, or even a social media manager, Belay has the right person and they are ready to help. To help get you started, Belay is offering their latest book entitled Delegate to Elevate, and it is absolutely free. In this little ebook, you'll learn how to stop diluting your efforts by trusting your team with more responsibility. This will empower you to courageously focus on your strengths and delegate your weaknesses, something we talk about all the time on the podcast, and it's going to help you develop your future leaders in the process. To claim this offer, just text the word Andy. That's A-N-D-Y to 55123. That's Andy to 55123 for your free copy today. And in no time, you'll be back to doing what only you can do, growing your organization. And now let's jump into today's content. The topic for this special edition podcast is how to get from where you are to where you want to be, something that is certainly relevant to both personal and organizational leadership. And joining me today is my Reverb co-host, Susie Gray. Take it away, Susie.
Thanks, Andy. This topic actually really resonates with me that we're going to be talking about today, and I'm super excited to jump into the content. It's something you actually talk about frequently with organizational leaders and also with our staff, and I've heard you give talks about it throughout the years. In fact, you've coined a phrase that encapsulates the insights you have on this topic. You refer to it as the principle of the path. So let's start there. What is the principle of the path?
Yeah, so this is something I kind of bumped into when teaching on this topic, and I'm always trying to come up with the phrase that pays, memorable is portable, you know, all that stuff. So the principle of the path is simply that direction, not intention, determines our destination. Or the short version, direction determines destination. But direction, not intention, determines our destination. And the dynamic of the phrase is there's a contrast, a huge contrast between direction and intention, because everybody, both personally in their self-leadership and in organizational leadership, our intent is always good. Our intentions are always good. You know, we say that all the time. Well, I had good intentions. But every leader knows intentions are irrelevant.
They're not going to get you anywhere.
No, they're not. And so there's so much emotion oftentimes behind intent. We think, well, that's enough. Or we don't really think that's enough, but we operate as if that's enough. So this principle, the principle of the path, just pulls us back into the reality that direction, not intention, determines our destination. That the direction you are currently traveling, professionally, relationally, financially, in your marriage, and the list goes on and on and on, the direction will ultimately determine where we end up in those respective areas. And this is true regardless of our goals, regardless of our dreams, our wishes and wants. Those are all intentions, right? What we intend to do, where we intend to go, where we intend to end up, or even who we intend to become. But again, intention doesn't determine anything. And I really thought about that sentence and thought, well, maybe intention determines something, but it doesn't. Not in the real world. It's just in the imaginary world. So intention doesn't determine anything. The dynamic or the catalyst for getting from where we are to where we want to be isn't intention. It's direction. Direction trumps intent every single time. So, and like any principle, and here's why we're talking about it, you can leverage it to your advantage, or you can ignore it to your detriment. This is in the operating system of life.
Yeah.
It's just an is. And recognizing it is one thing, leveraging it is another thing, and ignoring it is a third thing. And you ignore this principle, and you just don't end up where you wanted to be. In fact, again, this is something we talk about all the time. Every regret, professionally or personally, is really a destination of sorts, right? I mean, regret is a destination. Oh, no, I ended up there. Oh, no, the relationship ended up there. Oh, no, the company's culture ended up there. So a regret is a destination of sorts. So we decide our way there regardless of our intent. We decided our way to our regret. Looking back, it's evident in most cases that we chose a path that led to or ended with a regret. Never our intent, but again, intent is irrelevant. So that's the principle of the path.
Yeah, that is so true. And even though it's so true, we forget it in life.
Yeah.
So that's the negative side of the equation. But like you said, like any principle, you can leverage it to your advantage too.
Right. And that's the goal, right? To leverage this to our advantage. Direction, not intention, determines destination. So the goal then is to discover the path, in most cases, to discover the most direct path to where we want to go. And on a personal level, discover the path to who we want to be, what we want to become, and then get on it and then stay on it. And that's the challenge, right?
Keep it in front of you.
Keep it in front of you. Mm-hmm. Exactly. So the principle of the path is a reminder. Direction determines destination. Now, accepting this reality, which I don't think anyone, when you hear this, you push back on this and go, no, it doesn't, you know. Mm-hmm. Accepting this reality triggers something related that is equally important. So let me talk about that for just a minute. And that is that ultimately, we are responsible for our own lives. In other words, we have to take responsibility for our lives, specifically for our choices. And our choices are the steering wheel of our lives, right? I mean, we steer our lives by our choices. We choose or decide our way forward is another way of saying the same thing. So we choose and decide our direction. In other words, there's really no room for blame. The principle of the path says, at the end of the day, regardless of the outside forces, regardless of what they said, regardless of circumstances, at the end of the day, I have steered my life to the destination to which I have currently arrived, mm-hmm. relationally, professionally, financially, whatever it might be. And so the principle of the path says, hey, you're responsible. I'm responsible for my life, that we have to take responsibility for our lives, which is the same as saying we take responsibility for our choices. So there's no room for blame. There's no place for excuses. We choose the path, which means we are responsible for the destination, whether we like it or not. And there is always a tendency to look around to find somebody
else to blame
or something to blame.
That's
but the
right.
principle of the path says, nope, you chose a path. If you'd stopped to think about it, you probably knew where it was going to lead and you stayed on it anyway. Now, we're making this sound so simple because the principle is simple, but as we continue the discussion, there are some things that make this a little bit more complex, especially sometimes in organizational life.
Definitely in organizational life. It's almost easier in organizational life to externalize things, to say, no, it's because of that. But obviously, in every case, if nothing else, you choose your reaction to something that happened.
Right.
So I think this is, again, just highlights the importance of direction versus good intentions. So could you go deeper on why directions outweigh intentions when determining our destination?
Yeah. And again, this is so obvious. Once again, it's hardly worth stating, but knowing and doing are often completely unrelated, right? I mean, case in point, we know what we should eat. Mm-hmm. I'll just stop there. So knowing and doing, and I don't want to get off the subject, but how many times for the parents listening, just to put it in a context that it gets replicated in other contexts, have you been talking to one of your kids, especially middle school and high school, mm-hmm. and you're telling them something and they say, I know. And what they're communicating is, I already know this, so you don't need to tell me. And as a parent, we're thinking, I know that you know this, but you're not doing it.
You don't act like you know
this. You don't act like you know this, right? Your behavior doesn't—
I have no personal experience with this, but I heard some parents say that.
Yes, yeah. Well, that's exactly what happens. But as adults, we have the same propensity. It's like, I know. Okay, well then, if you know, why are you doing what you're doing? Well, that's the dilemma. Again, the principle is simple. The application sometimes is not. So sometimes we need reminding of the obvious. So to begin with, back to your question, intentions don't determine outcomes. At an elementary level, if we unintentionally put the wrong address into our GPS won't direct us to our intended destination, duh, right? Regardless of our intent. So at the end of the day, I think it's important for leaders, it's important for humans, but it's certainly important for leaders to differentiate and to be thoughtful about intent and direction. Because intention is so emotional, it's so broad, and in some cases it's somewhat nebulous, that I think it camouflages the fact that in spite of our energy, in spite of our pep talk, in spite of our vision cast, in spite of our, you know, you know, just the excitement around an idea. Okay, that's great. But is the path we're choosing actually the path, the most direct path to get us to where we want to be, either personally or organizationally? And in a minute, we'll talk about, again, why it's easier said than done.
Yeah. I would imagine organizationally in terms of, well, even just in terms of leadership, this applies to both your personal leadership and your organizational leadership.
Yeah.
So how can people ensure they're on the right path toward their own success?
Yeah. So let's talk about the personal side of this for just a minute. As we say all the time on our podcast, the person we all have to lead first is the person in the mirror, and the person in the mirror is always the most difficult person to lead. Because at the end of the day, self-leadership is the foundation of exceptional leadership. Self-leadership is the foundation of great organizational leadership. And anybody who's been in a company that went sideways because of decisions the leaders made or personal decisions the leaders made, they understand that. So the principle of the path underscores the importance of alignment. And this is so important. In fact, when I was preparing for this discussion, I had to stop and ask myself, am I applying what I'm about to read? Because it is so easy to lose sight of this. But anyway, the principle of the path underscores the importance of alignment between values and behaviors. Values and behaviors. Values are what we value most, right? That's pretty obvious. What we deem is most important, what we think is primary, the non-negotiables. And these are usually related to our character or to a person's character, what we value most. Accountability, honesty, loyalty, humility, you know, on and on and on, the list goes. And if we will think about our values in terms of being a destination, it's easy to see how the principle of the path intersects with all of this. Back to values and behaviors for just a minute. If what I value represents a destination, then my behaviors represent the path. If my values represent a destination and my behaviors represent the path, again, think about how this works. If that's the case, then the importance of alignment between values and behavior is extraordinarily important. Let me give an illustration. If I value accountability as a leader, the path to get there is accessibility and vulnerability with a select group of trusted friends. I mean, the only way to be accountable is to make myself available, to be vulnerable, and to be accessible to a group of trusted friends with either within the organization or board members or someone who are peers that I have invited into that conversation. That decision to make myself available and to be vulnerable is a behavior, which means it's a path that ultimately leads toward accountability. So,
which is your destination.
Which is the destination, right? I want to actually be accountable. But at the same time, if my intention is to be accountable, but I never go to the trouble of assembling a personal board of directors, as some people refer to it, or if I don't make myself available and accessible to peers, I'm choosing a path of unaccountability. I'm not sure that's a word. Or I'm choosing a path that is not going to lead to accountability. And here's where we deceive ourselves so easily. I may choose a path that doesn't lead to accountability while being absolutely convinced that accountability is important and even crucial to the success of me as a leader or to our organization.
Yeah.
So I'm absolutely convinced accountability is necessary. I intend to be accountable. I tell the people around me they should be accountable. I nod in agreement when people talk about accountability. But the question is, have I chosen a path personally that leads to accountability? And again, as obvious as it is when we talk about it, when we stop to think about it and we look at our own habits, we look at the way we manage our personal relationships and our professional relationships, we have to ask the question, okay, if this is something I value, whatever it might be, is the path I'm choosing, which means are the habits I'm embracing, moving me in that direction? Back to our context in terms of what we do, I've done so much premarital counseling. Mm-hmm. I've never met a couple that did not intend to live happily ever after. I mean, they all want to end together. We're going to, in spite of their family of origin, we're going to do it different. The intent is always there. And then you drill down and you begin asking about relational habits or what they intend to do as a married couple, what they intend to prioritize as a married couple.
To get there.
To get there.
Right.
Because, you know, when you've been married 35 years, you have some insight into what will get you there and what won't get you there.
Yeah.
And even in a relationship as important as a marriage, to see the disconnect sometimes between behaviors that are chosen versus the intent of happily ever after or finish together. It's
startling.
It's startling. Mm-hmm. But again, bring it back to the person in the mirror. Many of us, I think, struggle with this. There's actually a tragic example of this very thing in the Old Testament. Solomon, who is touted to be the wisest man who ever lived, certainly the wisest man who ever lived in his generation, he knew, if you read anything Solomon wrote, he knew where all the paths led, all of them. I mean, he articulated this so well in his sayings that have actually been in circulation for thousands of years. But when you read his story, so on one hand, you read his diary, you read his proverbs, you read all these fantastic sayings that are, you know, almost hallmarkish, you know, they're on posters.
He knows exactly what he should
do. Oh, my goodness. He's just given us all this great advice.
Yeah.
But then you read his biography, and he actually chose a path that can only be characterized as extremely unwise. He literally, to use our language, he lost his way after writing brilliantly about the best way to live. So yeah. If the wisest man who ever lived was that vulnerable to choosing a path that did not lead him to where he ultimately wanted to end up, even though he knew better and told other people better, again, I'm a fool to think that I'm just going to somehow magically, automatically choose the right path because my intentions are good. So the big takeaway from his story is knowing and doing are not two sides of the same coin. There's no actual correlation between knowing and doing. And just like there's no actual correlation between intention and direction. And last thing on this, and this is why it is so important for everybody, but maybe leaders in particular, to identify what they value most. And we've talked about this before. Sitting down and asking the question, what do I value most, and writing it down. Because what we want in the moment is rarely what we value most ultimately.
Ultimately, yeah.
I mean, every negative temptation, every bad temptation, whatever they are, is a temptation to ignore what we value most. It's an invitation to ignore our personal values. And every temptation represents a pathway. And what starts oftentimes as a pastime becomes a pathway. So because what we want most is really what we value most, it's so important to remember this. And when the thing that we want in the moment drives a behavior, we've actually stepped onto a path that will not take us to our desired destination because our values point in the direction where we ultimately want to go. So when a pastime starts to become a pathway, that's a yellow light or a red light, right? And when we ignore that, oftentimes our dreams don't come true. So backing up, it's so important for us to identify our values, like write them down, and then choose the path accordingly, one that actually takes us in the direction of our preferred future or our preferred destination.
Yeah, it's using the values as our North Star as a leader.
Yeah.
So I know I have, and I'm sure lots of people have faced obstacles and setbacks on their journey to where they're trying to go. So what advice would you give to people to keep them firmly on the path and not, you know, veer off into dead ends and cul-de-sacs?
Right. And I'm glad you brought this up, because when you talk about something like this in simplistic terms, real people are like, yeah, that's great. That works in the podcast studio,
Andy. Yes, that
Andy.
Works on a Hallmark card.
Yeah, but... As soon as you leave the podcast studio, Andy, does this really work in the real world? Yeah. So this goes back to what I just said. Setbacks are always a test of our values.
Yeah.
This is very important.
It's true.
If it's a financial setback, business setback, professional setback, setback in the family, as soon as there's a problem or a bump or an uh-oh or, oh my goodness, you got that phone call you dreaded, it is always a challenge to what we value most. In fact, setbacks, to use your word, actually reveal what we truly value most. Because when there are setbacks, we are forced to look for solutions, work ways around, ways forward. And oftentimes, and this isn't always true, but this is like a warning. I think every leader needs to just put this somewhere and remember, the most direct path forward during a difficult time is often a path that will require us to discount or abandon something we value. Usually our integrity. When there's a setback, because it's very emotional, and suddenly we gotta figure this out, we gotta get something done, I gotta jump in there and fix that. And our, especially for leaders who are so progress oriented, I mean, progress at all costs, including sometimes sacrificing our personal values, and to be able to pause and realize, wait a minute, I do have to address this, something has to be done, we've gotta fix this. But is the option I'm considering actually an option that leads me kind of roughshod right through or over something I value most.
Yeah.
And that's why the setbacks are usually always a test of what we value most. They're really a test of our values. So apart from setbacks, I don't know that we know what we value most.
Because you don't have to prove it.
Right. Until a value or until hanging on to something we value costs us something.
Right.
We don't know. We don't know how much we really value that, right? But when a leader is willing to pay a price professionally or personally for choosing what he or she values most, odds are they may not be on the most direct path to success or overcoming the obstacle, but they are on the right path. Again, going back to something we've talked about before, it's what story do I want to tell? What story do I want to tell? When we finally get through this crisis, when we finally overcome this unexpected turn of events at home, when this is just a story we tell as a company, when this is just a story I tell as a leader, what story do I want to tell? And the story we want to tell is, even in the midst of the crisis, I did not abandon what I value most. Even though it took me longer to overcome, even though it took me longer to get around, even though it was more expensive, even though it cost me more, the story I want to tell is I clung to what was most valuable, even through the difficulty, and I avoided the temptation to step off the path that leads me to where I ultimately want to be, even though that was the easier way through and around the difficulty. And I would imagine anybody 35 or older who's listening to this, we can all think of those moments in time.
Yep.
But if we can stop and remember in the moment, okay, this isn't the end. This is a story I'm going to tell. This is a setback. And I want to be able to tell a story that says, I clung to what was most valuable, even in the midst of this unexpected turn of events. But sometimes, because the emotions are so strong, it's just easier to react.
And push through.
Yeah. And the human superpower, the superpower that all of us have that we don't think of as a superpower, but it is our superpower, is our ability or our power to respond rather than react. That's our superpower. We don't have to act on instinct like an animal. We have the power to be objective, to let the emotions settle down, and then make a decision that in some cases is contrary to how we feel.
I mean, that requires a pause. That requires the ability to lift yourself above the energy of the moment and say, okay, wait, what should I do? So what advice would you give to a leader who realizes, uh-oh, I took the expedient route and I think I'm on the wrong path and it's not going to lead to where I say I want to go? What would you tell a leader?
Well, that's an important question as well, because our immediate reaction is to try to fix things. But the better paradigm isn't fixing something that's broken. It's to go back to the language we're using around the principle of the path. The principle of the path is direction, not intention, determines destination. So think about it this way. When you're driving and you realize you're lost, you don't approach that dilemma like it's a problem to be solved. It's not a problem to be solved. It's a direction that needs to be changed. Mm-hmm. And that's a very important distinction, because if you need to change your direction and you approach it as a problem that needs to be fixed, you will begin attacking a problem and potentially never change your direction. Leaders who are on the wrong path are actually living or leading in the wrong direction. This is important. A leader who's on the wrong path, whether it's professionally or personally, they're actually leading or living in the wrong direction. The challenge is, when we decide to live in a different direction, things don't get better initially, and things don't get better quickly. So we're tempted to conclude, well, this isn't helping. But it will if we stick to it. Here's why I say that. The reason it gets worse is that living in the right direction or leading in the right direction requires that we take responsibility for the mess we made while living or leading in the wrong direction.
And often no one wants to do that.
That was my next sentence. And nobody wants to do that. I don't want to clean up a mess. I want to move forward.
Just move past it. Can't we just not look over there?
Exactly. I feel like I'm going backwards, and leaders hate to go backwards.
That.
But again, think about if you're driving. If you miss a turn, what do? You retrace your steps. You have to move in a different direction, and it feels like you're wasting time. So this requires brutal honesty.
Mm-hmm.
It requires us to refuse to blame, and it requires that we refuse to make excuses. It requires that we make restitution. that we apologize. It's terrible.
Yeah.
It's wonderful. It's progress. It's the right direction. So the point being, there's no instant solution for being lost while driving, and there's not an instant solution for living in the wrong direction either. You don't fix a direction. You change a direction.
Yeah. So it feels pretty clear how this principle intersects with personal leadership, but this principle also applies to organizations, doesn't it?
Yeah. The direction of a company or the direction of an organization actually determines the destination of the organization. So the principle is the same, right?
Yep.
And again, intention is irrelevant. We're going to be the biggest and the best, but yeah, but if you're not on a path to make you the biggest and the best, you know, intention doesn't matter. So here's the difference and here's the sameness. Organizations are generally quick to course correct because there's so much at stake for so many people. As individuals, we are not quick to course correct. We just hide
because we're blind to it.
Well, exactly. Again, we don't have an outside board of directors. We don't, you know. So, but organizations are generally, I should say, quicker to course correct because there's so much at stake for so many people. Consequently, healthy organizations, and again, the operative word there is healthy, healthy organizations are more brutally honest about what's happening in the organization than individuals are about what's going on in their heads,
yeah.
Right? Because if
not as visible.
Exactly. I'm having conversations with myself, right? Trying to figure this out. So the path to profitability is so important to organizations. They tend to respond more quickly. Profitability is to a for-profit company what food and water is to an individual. They can't survive without it. And there's usually a built-in systems of accountability within organizations. Organizations are generally accountable to groups, investors, a board, customers. And the other advantage that organizations have is that they measure success more objectively, right? They count things, they measure things, they benchmark things, they compare themselves against industry standards. The scoreboard for an organization is more obvious.
Because of those stakeholders you mentioned earlier.
Exactly. There's sort of a built-in accountability that you better get this thing on the right path or there's going to be trouble for—
Yeah, the board or the stakeholders are not going to be happy.
Yeah, they're not going to remain quiet while you keep telling them about your intentions.
Right.
For-profit companies in particular can't move in the wrong direction for too long without it taking a toll, a noticeable toll. And if leadership doesn't turn things around, the board steps in and they just choose
another leader.
Another leader, right. But having said that, we all know stories of companies, large and small, who fell in love with the way they did business or fell in love with their product. And when either or both became obsolete, either the way they were doing business or the product, they just stayed on their comfortable path, which, of course, led to an uncomfortable destination.
Yeah.
So this is where this principle comes to bear, I think, in organizational life. It's why I say all the time to organizational leaders, marry the mission, date the model. Marry the mission, date the model. Or marry the mission, date the product. Mm-hmm. Marry the mission, but date the service you're providing. A business model, a product, or a service really is a means to an end. It's a path to a location. And when it's no longer moving the organization toward the preferred destination, it's got to be changed. It's got to be jettisoned. And that's hard, right? Because leaders, and I put myself in this category, we fall in love with what we've created, and we fall in love with what we're good at, and we fall in love with the way we do what we're good at.
Because oftentimes it's emotional to abandon something that's been built that you feel like you've personally
created. We were successful.
Right.
And it was successful then. You know, we'll just talk louder. Right? We'll just push harder in the wrong direction. Yeah. And again, the metaphor is now you're just driving faster in the wrong direction, thinking that it's going to get you where you need to go.
We'll get back there. We're going to get back on track.
Right. Yeah.
No, you got to change direction.
Susie, this is why, as you know, and because you've actually seen this, I keep this quote from Andy Grove from his book, Only the Paranoid Survive, on my credenza. In fact, recently you and I were having a conversation. I pointed over your shoulder and said, you know,
we know the answer to that question.
Yeah. And for those of you who don't know the story, he was the CEO and president of Intel for like 20 years. He loved making computer chips, but Intel was rapidly losing market share to the Japanese. And so he's sitting in his office, he describes the environment, and he's looking out the window, and he turns, I think it was to Craig Barrett, who eventually replaced him at Intel. He looked at him and he said, if we got kicked out and the board brought in a new CEO, what would he do? And Andy said, Craig immediately shot back, he would get us out of the chip business. And Andy Grove says, well, then why shouldn't we walk out the door and do it ourselves? Yeah. In other words, let's pretend like we got kicked out. Let's pretend like we're the new guys. Let's do the thing we know the next group would do. That little exchange is so enlightening for me. And again,
it's scary and clarifying.
It's so clarifying because the new group has no emotional attachment to any of this.
To any of it. They want to make the right decision.
They're 100% for what's best for the company. That's right. And they're going to get the company on the path that will take them to where they ultimately want to go. Again, Intel's direction was not leading to a desired destination, and Andy and his team stopped doing something they loved, something they enjoyed, and they ultimately saved the company. So yeah, this principle applies to leaders who want to lead themselves well, but it applies to the organizations they lead as well. All that to say, intention isn't a strategy, because the principle of the past said direction, not intention, determines our destination.
So true, so true. Well, as we close our podcast today, is there any final thoughts or action steps that you would offer to our audience?
Yeah, I would just say, if you haven't already done the exercise of asking yourself, what do I value most? What's most important to me? You got to do that.
Yeah.
Because that's fundamental. And you write those things down. And then you look at your life, look at your calendar, look at your schedule, and ask the question, okay, is the path I'm currently on going to get me there? And one thing that brings objectivity to this exercise is imagine you're having this conversation with someone else, someone who comes to you with your list of values, and they say to you, this is what's most important to me. This is who I want to become. This is where I want to end up with my family. This is where I want to end up relationally, financially, whatever it might be. And then you ask them, okay, well, what habits?
How are you going to get there?
Yeah, what are you currently doing to get there?
Yeah.
And what are you currently doing that may be leading you in a different direction?
Because they're incongruent. Yeah.
And then the other thing I would say along these lines is this. Imagine you're talking to one of your children. And they've said to you, Mom or Dad, this is what I want to be. This is where I want to go. And you are saying to one of your kids, okay, are you doing the things to get you there? Because that's a conversation at some level, even if you don't have this terminology, that we all have with our kids. So let's model that for them.
Yeah.
Let's choose the path that will get us where we ultimately want to be. So that's how you get from where you are to where you ultimately want to be. And Susie, that's all the time we have for today. Thank you so much for joining me. And thanks to all of our listeners. Be sure you visit the andystanley.com website, where you can download the Leadership Podcast application guide that includes a summary of our discussion, plus some questions for reflection or group discussion. And to all you parents out there, this might be a good application guide to check out in terms of a discussion you might want to begin with your middle school and high school students as it relates to the principle of the path. And be sure to join us next time on the Andy Stanley Leadership Podcast.